Journey there will not be so long because it's just several kilometers from Capernaum. On the right side, there is a tower, Migdal. Exactly, probably that tower that gave the name to the city. Probably not. There might be several towers. So in the beginning, it seems that it was a kind of a field, a kind of a, I don't know what, to of collecting harvest. And there was a Сторожевая башня, watchtower, that gave the name to the settlement that I mentioned here. And after it was already a village or a city, and probably nobody knew what tower was here in the very beginning, that's why it's not necessary that this tower is the very first tower of this village. So the place of exorcism of that demons from a possessed man, there is a problem where it was exactly. So Father Ilias told that it was exactly in this place of Kursi. In reality, we don't know this, because in the Gospel there are three different names given in different Gospels to that place where it was. Sometimes it's named Strana Gergesinskaya, a land of Gergasa. So probably, if evangelist meant this very city, it is situated not in Israel at all. It is situated in contemporary Jordan, so it's Jerash. So it was not in the very city of Jerash, but on the seashore near that city. Another version is Strana Gadarinskaya, the land of Gadara, and so on. So there are three different versions, and Kursi, it is a late form, probably, of one of these names. So it can, so for sure that event took place on the eastern side of the Sea of Galilee, so on the opposite seashore. It's for sure, and that there were several pagan cities. But we don't know exactly where was this event, in which of them. Probably it was not in the city, but just in a field, not far from the seashore. Also, what is important, that all these pagan cities, Greek cities, step by step, they became Christian cities in Byzantine time. So there was Christian population there from the very beginning, probably not from the first, but from the second Christian generation. And after the baptism of the Emperor Constantine and after Christianization of the Roman Empire, these cities, the Christian population grew larger and larger, and these cities became rather important. And in the city of Kursi, there was a big, really big monastery with a big cathedral that looks like a little bit as some monasteries near Jerusalem. Probably you'll visit them with an archaeologist on Sunday. So there is a city and there is a monastery. Another city nearby is named Ippos or Susita. We spoke about it already. It's near Kursi, and it's also a city that we know after excavations as one of the city of Decapolis, the city Gradia, a community of 10 pagan cities here in the land, the Holy Land, in Israel and in Jordan. And we know that the Bishop of Ippos of Palestine took part in the First Ecumenical Council. So it was an important city here. But the capital of Byzantine land of Israel, of Byzantine Holy Land, was not Jerusalem, it was Caesarea that we're going to visit in the end of the week. So it was a city founded by Herod the Great, and that became a capital. Even the Bishop of Jerusalem was subjected to the Bishop of Caesarea till the Fourth Ecumenical Council, till the 5th century. So former pagan cities, they became more important here than the Jewish cities. Destroyed by the earthquake in the middle of the 8th century, as Father Ilya spoke about it yesterday. So a lot of cities here, they were destroyed. What does it mean, a destruction of the city during an earthquake? Of course, it doesn't mean that the city, all the buildings, all the streets, everything was ruined so much that it was impossible to restore. Of course not, but very often it meant that the sources of the water were closed, so there was no more water in that place, and you're not going to take water from the Sea of Galilee. That's why people did not restore the city, because it was much more convenient to choose another place. In Kursis, probably it was the same. In Beit Shan, it was the same. The city in Galilee that he'll cross by tomorrow on the way to Jerusalem and Jericho. As for Capernaum, it was a different story because it was a city very much connected with the commerce, with the trade between the land of Israel and Syria and Jordan and so on. So it was a crossroad. And after the Arab conquest, these trade ways, they have changed. So the city of Capernaum have lost its economical importance. That's why it becomes a village step by step. And after it is, so it is not even destroyed but abandoned. So I think that here we have one of the Byzantine cities. And probably the most interesting thing here is a big church, a big cathedral, that was built here probably in commemoration of the expulsion of the demons from the possessed man. But probably not, it was just a cathedral of this big city.
Chapels were that, according to archaeological recreation, were built in the place of the caves or tombs where gathering demoniacs were kept while they were possessed. And also behind the monastery, there are some excavations with cells in the guest house. So they mentioned in one time it was one of the largest Byzantine monasteries in Palestine. As far as the any particular explanation, probably it's better for us to go a little bit in the shadow because it's afternoon, it's quite dark. So for us not to get a heat stroke, let us try to find the little shadow. I don't know, it doesn't look like there are too much leaves, but at least there are some benches where we can sit. Right around the building.
There's some walls over there.
Yeah.
Yes.
There.
No, well, just I'd like to say a couple of words.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Not inside of the church.
That's mean.
Of course, this church is very much reconstructed. If we'd like to visit another city nearby that is named Iphos or Susita, they will have a lot of churches that are not reconstructed, and we'll see them as they were excavated. But what is interesting here? Now, delta of this change, and it is the axis, how do you say in English? Apse. So a place especially built in basilicas for the altar, and sitting places for the priests. So it was named in Latin and in Greek Presbyterium, sitting place for the priests, and in the main part of Presbyterium there was a place for bishops. Yes, so they are sitting exactly the place for the bishops. What is also interesting here, that what is it, do you know?
Это для жертвоприношения. No?
No.
Candles?
No, it's not a candle at all, of course. Today morning I was asking our fathers who celebrated, is it good to open the doors of the altar in the very beginning? And Father Lawrence told, of course it will be good, because here iconostasis is really high. And of course there it is not high in comparison with really many levels of iconostasis that were in later ecclesiastical practice. But in the beginning, in early Byzantine tradition, was, as it is now more or less kept in Latin tradition, there was a kind of separation wall between the altar and the main part of the church. And it was like this. So it was, of course it was not laid down, it was standing. It was a fixed column, and so one column was here, and another was here, and between them you can see where the marble plate entered. So it was a kind of small wall.
No, yes. It was. We're going to see a very beautiful example of it. We're going to have a perfect example that we're going to see in Petra, where a church destroyed by earthquake is going to be restored. And those of you who have been to Sinai, you saw that altar, there were marble slabs of about 3 feet high that were sliding in these holders. In time when columns were, you know, mounted every so often, or they may have not been mounted at all, there were holders like this one over here, placed in the area where the stairs down would start for the clergy to enter during the procession, and marble slabs would go like tablets sliding in.
Mm-hmm.
And usually the depiction of the Byzantine cross that you see on this column.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Or depiction of various animals. Peacocks were very prominent, because peacock, according to tradition, when it dies, the flesh does not rot, and it represented in itself the image of incorruption, the image of eternity. Also, at times, the word sheep depicts more symbolical images. But that'd be very, very small. That'd be very, very small, not more than 3 feet small, with a grand opening in the middle. Actually, I don't know if you know or not, how Christians come to use the basilicas is when persecution ceased, and Constantine, who favored Christianity, he did not make it a state religion. It's a very common mistake to say Constantine made Christianity state religion. It's not true. Christianity was made state religion considerably later.
It was made just a legal religion.
It was made illegal. He legalized, right. So he favored Christians, and he wanted to compensate them somehow for the persecution, because persecution included not only the killing of Christians, but very often expropriation of their properties. And he could not compensate, obviously, individuals for the persecution, but he wanted compensating with the statue of an emperor. Statue of an emperor, whether he sit under it or in absence of the emperor, the official who administrate the justice would be representing Roman authority, Pax Romana, the Roman world, sitting under the statue of the emperor. And people would come, and the court procedure would be in place, or whatever ceremonial or official administrative inaugurations of various sorts, or all sorts of city business. And when these buildings were not in official use, people also could come there for market, for trade purposes, because if say to be hidden from the elements. So that's how the Roman officials, as it was presented, you know, good PR, were taking care of the people, providing them some place together. So Constantine, when he legalized Christianity, he gave some of these buildings to the church communities. Why he would do that? Can anybody give me an answer? No ideas? Why such big structures he gave? Huh? For gathering. It was, if anybody heard such statement, where is a bishop, there is a church. It was ultimately important for all Christians to get together. There were no parishes. There were no parish churches. Why we in every city, especially if you travel in Europe, there was always a cathedral. In town where there are many, many parish churches. It's where the bishop is. So originally, all the Christian community could fit into one building. They were too numerous to fill the smaller place, but big basilicas were adequate for them to have a worship. So where the bishop would celebrate, and of course there was no, you know, gradation between the clergy. It was a little bit different, like a bishop, deacon, and a priest. So the priest was more consultative body. Priests were like parish councils. By the way, parish council is an American invention. Parish councils do not exist anywhere at all. It's not really a Christian tradition, if you think about it. But the function of the presbyters, number 12, were assist bishop to interpret the scripture, and he had most of the functions as the priest has today. But deacons were administrators of the parish and at the same time liturgical functionaries, but was much more reduced capabilities as they are today. So modern-day priest, like myself, Father Lawrence or Father Jim, is an interbreed between a bishop of antiquity and a deacon. And by the way, there were not three orders of the clergy, but there were nine ranks. But we're not going to go into that now. But so here we have a little, but very excellent lesson in the liturgical archaeology. And we're going to talk more about that in Jordan, because in Jordan churches are in much better state of preservation. But just for you to get an idea, here we have the first church, you know, one of the early churches that were patterned after the fashion of basilica. Christians found them very useful. An elevated place became an imitation of Holy of Holies in Jerusalem Temple. There was people for a place for people together, because this is heaven. This is heaven. I'm saying, why women can enter to the altar?
Because they don't enter the heaven.
Because this is true interpretation. But let's talk about other things. Nobody enters. It's functionality. Even clergy do not just enter it. It's not the place where anybody dwells by the Holy Spirit. Place of congregation is in the middle. God presides over thing. We're approaching him, there is always a movement. And there was always very big court of pagans, Dvor Yezichnikov, where people were those who were preparing for the holy baptism, and those who were penitent, because there were big penance, and in times the discipline was rather severe, would gather there. Right, but these were also placed here, because they probably were fixed right over here. And there will be marble slabs affixed into it, and there are two rows of column, and there would be pointed roof. After reading the Gospel, I give you a little bit of a free time. Father Alexander very justly pointed that it's not one place where this have happened, because in Jordan there is such an archaeological site as Umm Qais, where there is a huge remnant of a huge basilica, very beautiful, that marks a very significant historical event, which points out that site may also have been considered as one of the miracles of Jesus, because it resembles some of the other churches were built that associated with the life of Christ. And there were not too many of them that happened on this side of Jordan River or this, you know, this side of the Lake of Galilee. However, what I want to use this place as an example, because it's obvious that there was a tradition, one of the conflicting traditions, but nevertheless a tradition, and Christians saw no problem with it, to name this place where the healing took place. As you'll be going out, and you'll be looking around, there is no cliff from which 2,000 swine can rush into the sea. And those of you who swim in the Lake of Galilee, that shore of the lake is much more steeper than this one. Yeah. From this side, you can go right into the middle of the lake, and it's not going to be higher than your chest. How in the world 2,000 you know, a poor Kun could say. And here's a question, and I ask some of you about that. As we read Gospel in today's presentation with division on chapters and verses and highlights in red and marks on the sides, you know, good point and things of that nature, is it a historical account as we take it or not?
What exactly?
The description of the story of the swine.
Yes.
Fine.
It's not a preacher.
It's not parable.
It's not a parable.
Second thing, your story, most of you would visit the Inn of the Good Samaritan, those of you who would be going to Qumran and Masada. Is story about the Good Samaritan a historical event or a parable, at least as we present it and read it in today's Gospel?
It's a parable.
Now, Christians come and settled in the places that were associated with the earthly life of the Savior. So over here there is a historical one, they build the basilicas, there is no cliff. Okay, cliff is problematic. But how about one of the greatest saints settling on the places where perhaps Manassas was before him, and how about the historical place of the Good Samaritan's Inn, if it's purely a parable?
But it's symbolic. It is because in the Gospel it's named that it's on the way from Jerusalem to Jericho, and they build it in the midst of the road.
Father, I'll allow myself to be a little bit Theresian. There is Father Paul Terazi, St. Vladimir Seminary. Okay? I'm not, I'm using his method, even he's considered to be heretic by many, for very just cause. I'm trying to use this. What is the purpose of the stories? And I'm going to repeat it endlessly, these presentations. Well, anyway, let's read the Gospel. Father Basil, would you like to do that? It's Gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 5, verses 1 to 20. And maybe we'll leave you on the altar and we'll stop in the sun for a second, huh? Let us step out of the altar. We'll imitate Byzantine monks who are staying here in Pais.
And that we may be made worthy to hear the Holy Gospel, let us pray to the Lord God.
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Wisdom attend the reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark.
Glory to thee, O Lord, glory to thee.
Let us attend. They came to the other side of the sea, to the country of the Gerasenes. And when he had come out of the boat, there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who lived among the tombs. And no one could bind him any more, even with a chain. For he had often been bound with fetters and chains, but the chains he wrenched apart, and the fetters he broke in pieces, and no one had the strength to subdue him. Night and day among the tombs and on the mountains, he was always crying out and bruising himself with stones. And when he saw Jesus from afar, he ran and worshipped him, and crying out with a loud voice, he said, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I adjure you by God, do not torment me." For he had said to him, "Come out of the man, you unclean spirit." And Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" He replied, "My name is Legion, for we are many." And he begged him eagerly not to send them out of the country. Now a great herd of swine was feeding there on the hillside, and they begged him, "Send us to the swine, let us enter them." So he gave them leave, and the unclean spirits came out and entered the swine, and the herd, numbering about 2,000, rushed down the steep bank into the sea and were drowned in the sea. The herdsmen fled and told it in the city and in the country, and people came to see what it was that had happened. And they came to Jesus and saw the demoniac sitting there, clothed and in his right mind, the man who had the legion, and they were afraid. And those who had seen it told what had happened to the demoniac and to the swine. And they began to beg Jesus to depart from their neighborhood. And as he was getting into the boat, the man who had been possessed with demons begged him that he might be with him. But he refused and said to him, "Go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you, and how he has had mercy on you." And he went away and began to proclaim in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him. And all men marveled.
Glory to thee, O Lord, glory to thee.
Thank you, Father Basil. And now, again, the most interesting things, will please see the side galleries. The mosaics are quite a bit left. Very interesting. You can see wonderful oil press on my right hand side, on your left hand side, and also a little baptistry. Walls, of course, were higher. And those of you who do not mind the heat, you can, as you're exiting from the basilica complex, turn left
and go by the clearly marked path, and up to some on some elevation, there are
remnant of the chapels that built into the tombs. Who, according to tradition, the demoniacs were, and it was all obviously associated with the monastery. So there's not too much left there, but sight's very impressive, and also beautiful view of the lake. So it's not a very high climb, and it's maybe 5 minute walk up the hill. And those of you who speak Russian, you are most welcome to stay behind, and I'll explain to you just in several words what was said.
No, все то, что было объяснено по-английски. То, что ранние иконостасы, они были очень маленькими, то, что мы видим, приходит из Византии в XI веке, вот, то оно не было такое большое, как мы видим сейчас. Базиликальные здания, они были римского происхождения, римское правосудие в них совершалось, большое здание, куда приходили люди, для того, чтобы на ней вершился суд, различные судебные процессы проходили, ну, а также люди собирались в праздничные дни, или не в праздничные дни, и могли, скажем, там, поторговаться, прячась от солнца и от дождя. Христианам Константин начал первый передавать базилики, потому что он хотел компенсировать. У него была симпатия к христианству, хотя он сам христианином стал только на смертном одре, он хотел каким-то образом эти гонения компенсировать. Он передал часть базилик, потому что христиане собирались как община все вместе в каком-то определенном месте, где был епископ, где совершалось богослужение епископа. Вот поэтому первые христианские церкви, они напоминали те самые базилики, в которых они изначально, им было разрешено легально собираться и служить. И базилика получила очень удачную интерпретацию, когда возвышенное место, где сидел судья или сам император, переносилось и называлось Святая Святым, Святая Святых, как в Иерусалимском храме, основная часть, где были верующие, и притвор, где размещались кающиеся грешники, люди, готовящиеся к крещению. Поскольку народ напирал, очень часто дети играли, Святая Святых, как по подобию завесы, была немножко отделена. Кстати, завеса могла быть и в раннем храме, на самом деле это очень трудно установить, было или не было. И были мраморные плиты высотой примерно метр. Кто был на Синае, видели после того, как мы поклонились мощам Святой Екатерины, там небольшое такое возвышение было. Но вы не были на Синае, мы увидим в Петре. Напомните мне, чтобы я вам показал. Там храм восстановлен, там эти плиты сохранились. Были колонны, возможно, несколько, а также были маленькие такие колодки, куда эти мраморные плиты вставляли. На них были или византийские кресты, или изображения животных, обычно павлинов или овец. Жертвенный ягненок или павлин, тело которого не разлагается после смерти. Это, скорее всего, основание престола, и здесь, скорее всего, лежали мощи какого-либо мученика, да, потому что с ранних времен совершалось богослужение на мощах мучеников. Вот. Это что касается места, где мы находимся. Это был один из крупнейших византийских монастырей в Палестине. Откопан он был примерно 20 лет назад. Это одно из нескольких мест, которые называют местом, где произошло исцеление бесноватого. Никакой горы, с которой туча свиней побежала в море, вы можете дойти до половины озера и все равно не утонете. Нет, но тем не менее христиане отождествляли это место вот именно с местом исцеления. Значит, либо они все были немножко странные, с приветом, ибо им было все равно на то, что указано в Евангелии, либо история с Евангелием немножко более сложная, чем буквальное воспринятие слова за слово. То есть был какой-то элемент притчи в этой истории. То есть я не говорю о том, что не произошло исцеление, я говорю о том, что содержание гораздо глубже. Так же, как, например, и царь со мной, я так понял, не согласился, мы еще поговорим на эту тему, но единственное место по притче, где построен какой-то церковный комплекс, это притча о милосердном самаряне. Но если это притча, этого не было, то зачем там что-то строить, чтобы напоминать людям, где это произошло, если это было только... Значит, это история, предложенная Христом к размышлению. И тут мы видим, как важно правильно подходить к евангельскому тексту, как важно пытаться отделить тот элемент истории, который очень искусительно нам наше сознание предлагает воспринимать все это как такую, знаете, полукрасивую сказку, благочестивую легенду, и в то же время как важно смотреть на содержание. Все Евангелие было написано без раздела на строки, на главы, сплошным текстом. Не было отделения того, что сказано о Христе, и то, что сказано Христом. Это все было равнозначно. Нельзя отделять, нельзя подчеркивать. Это не история, это не хронология, это не биография, это книга спасения. И вот эти два места, то есть, с одной стороны, мы видим как бы описание исторического события, которое имеет явный элемент притчи, при всем при том, как нам это место указывает. Именно ли это или нет, это уже не важно совершенно. Что важно, что это место отождествляло, сюда люди приходили, они читали именно это Евангелие, то, что мы прочитали сегодня. И гостиница Милосердного Самарянина, которая как бы к истории как таковой не имеет отношения, потому что это же притча, это же учение. Ни по одной притче больше ничего не построено. Значит, в истории о Милосердном Самарянине есть историческое зерно, которое было употреблено Христом для учения, да? И вот в этой истории, которая как бы точно произошла, как она была описана, есть элемент учения. И в данной ситуации получается, что сказано в притче, что сказано в истории, является для нас абсолютно равное и важное значение. Часовенки наверху, там, где жили в гробах одержимые.